Julian needs no introduction. He's been around MaxEnt for quite a long time. And I wanted to also mention, probably unbeknownst to some people as well, that he was really quite principal in putting together the maximum entropy workshops that we use to try to deal with Jane's Foundation monies and things like that to help facilitate workshops in the future and back and forth. So anyway, a little bit more on vision, and take it away.
Okay. I'll stand up so you can see where I am, but I'm going to have to sit down to give you the presentation. This is kind of a continuation of what Kevin talked about last year in France. We have a NASA project that we were actually, Ben and I were working on finishing up while Kevin was giving the presentation in France. So I'm going to talk about calibrating and aligning low-cost vision and inertial navigation system. Okay. The opportunity that presents itself here is that both in the automotive industry and the home game industry, there's a large market for cheap inertial measurement units that are, MEM stands for micro-electromechanical systems. So they're actually machined on in a process very similar to making electronic chips. And also then cell phones have a large market for cheap electronic cameras. So there's a lot of cheap little components out there. And our hope is to, and also embedded computers and digital signal processors have gotten really cheap too. So our hope is to put all that together into a system that can combine machine vision and inertial measurement units. And mainly because those two things have complementary error characteristics. Inertial systems tend to have long-term drifts, while vision has short-term noises. And putting the two together can make a much better system. So our project objective is we're finally under funding again for phase two after all the machinations of the US government. And we're funded to do phase two of this project. We're working with UAlbany and with Worcester Polytechnic Institute now. They have a large robotics program from the undergraduate level on up. And the objective is to develop a brass board prototype system for an integrated self-contained vision inertial system. And again, I'm just saying we're combining machine vision with inexpensive MEMS gyros and accelerometers. And we're trying to provide accurate surface navigation areas where satellites and beacons are not available. Obviously, if we're doing planetary exploration, there's not going to be GPS satellites without a lot of cost putting them up. But it's also useful for, indoors and on the Earth and underground and so forth. The contract we're working on is a 24-month phase two project now, so we have more time to try to do things right, which we had to kind of not do so well in the first phase. The signal flow diagram you saw up last year, I think, we're using three instruments, basically, with the MEMS IMU and then two cameras. The MEMS IMU drives inertial navigation calculations, which I'll show you in a few minutes. Those actually aid in computing from the stereo cameras in the inverse depth, keeping track of the inverse depth of the objects that are in the vision field of the cameras. And we do then what's called optical flow using inertial calculations. So we're basically determining how the image should change from one time to the next. We're predicting that using the inertial system and the previous image. And then we're comparing it to the actual image that we observe. And that gives us a flow of, well, if you think about it, if you're going down the road, telephone poles are going past you this way, right? Or if you're turning, they go sideways. You know, so you can tell the difference between angular motion and linear motion if you know the depth of things. All that gets fed into a Bayesian information filter, which is really an extended common filter for our purposes. We also will do feature tracking, feature extraction, which means we find an object that has some unique characteristics we think we can find in the next image, and we keep track of that. We use that as a position fix for the Bayesian information filter. That fixes any long-term errors that leak through the original optical flow fixes. And then our ultimate goal is to do simultaneous localization and mapping. So we want the robot to be able to localize itself and map its environment. So this is the signal flow for inertial navigation coupled with the camera. And this is a slide Kevin had last year. One of the things we have to do is calibrate the accelerometer and gyro signals, and I'm going to talk to you about that today. Once we do that, we really just solve Newton's second equation of motion. And we're assuming a flat Earth because we're not moving around very much with this. But gyros, of course, can sense only specific force, the force per unit mass applied to the case. And that includes the forces countering gravity. So we have to take out gravity by knowing the local gravity vector. We obtain angular velocities from the gyros. And we keep track of that with quaternions and produce direction cosine matrices from the quaternions. And then, of course, we can, once we have the acceleration in the local navigation frame, we can integrate twice to get velocity and position. And then finally, we want to take that over, transfer the body velocity and angular rate to the camera so we can do this optical flow thing. And I'll talk to you about this part today, too. So first, the MIMS IMU error models. This is what you can get for $60 nowadays. This Spark Fun is a company that sells to the hobby electronics market. And this has a three-axis accelerometer from Analog Devices on it, and a three-axis gyro, this keeps going out on me, from InvaSense. And actually the gyro has some additional computation on it. It's got a little computer on it that does some additional calculations and gathers data from the accelerometer and buffers the data and does all sorts of nice things for you. And that's how big it is. It's relative to a quarter. I guess I better use this. There. So it's small. It doesn't use much power. But it's not all that accurate. Okay, the accelerometer, it gives a digital output, but 10-bit resolution. The range is plus or minus 2 Gs, which is just fine for robots. The scale factor, though, has a typical value, but it also has a range that's quoted here, which is a fairly significant range. That's from unit to unit, essentially. Also, it has a significant bias. So this is milliGs. So it has typically plus or minus 40 milliGs, but up to plus or minus 150. And if you look at the fine print on the spec sheet, these are derived from about 5 or 6 tests. So it's not sure we should trust these too much anyway. The Z accelerometer actually has a larger range of bias. And these are the things we're going to have to try to calibrate out or at least characterize so we can know how to build the common filter. There's a nonlinearity that's pretty small, 0.5% of full scale, which translates to, I believe, a tenth or a hundredth of a millig, which we can pretty much ignore, we think. The internal axis misalignments are pretty small, too, a tenth of a degree. There is a cross-axis sensitivity that they quote as plus or minus 1 degree. I'm not sure what that actually means, but that's what they quote. So we're going to actually account for, in our estimation, some misalignment errors. There is a sensitivity to temperature of these units, and it's fairly significant. It's 0.8 of a millig per degree C. And we may take this thing out in the desert to test it, so we've got to make sure we understand what happens there. For the gyros, they're 16-bit resolution. If you set the range to, well, you can set the range on it, but we'll set the range to 250 degrees plus or minus 250 degrees per second. If we do that, then the scale factor error, scale factor translates to 131 degrees per, well, the least one least significant bit corresponds to, wait a minute, 131 least significant bits per degrees per second, okay? And there's a plus or minus 3% at like room temperature kind of a thing. But there's a 2% variation over the range. So the scale factor error has some variation with temperature, but even worse than that is the zero rate bias has a large variation with temperature. And it has a significant bias. Also, gyros, which are basically tuning forks oscillating, for some reason have a constant bias and then a bias that varies from turn on to turn on. So every time you turn it on, you get a slightly different bias. There's a noise that's fairly insignificant, but still needs to be accounted for. There's a, they quote the noise as a power spectral density of 0.01 degrees per second for square root of hertz. So I'm not sure quite how these numbers all square together. There is a low pass filter built in that cuts off some of the higher frequency stuff. So I'm not sure exactly what they've done there. That's part of what we have to find out. So how do we try to figure out what these things are really all about? We can do static tests. So we're going to do a sequence of tests, six known orientations. In other words, we put it in a box, and we turn it every direction relative to the gravity vector. And we do it at controlled temperatures, different controlled temperatures. So we keep the temperature constant, do the six tests, and then change the temperature. And we also look at turning the power off, turning it back on, see if things change. We'll also do dynamic tests with at least with six orientations on a rotating turntable and at stable temperatures as well to find out the gyro scale factors, basically. And we're going to look at a range of rotation rates and temperatures. I guess I need to point out, in the spirit of this being a workshop, I'm telling you our plans, but you're not going to see any results yet because we just got started. Okay. So the simplified measurement equations look like this. We dropped out the nonlinear terms and just have the things like the scale factor error and the misalignment errors, which are represented as unit vectors from the IMU body coordinates to the actual instrument itself. So these are unit vectors, but they aren't necessarily orthogonal to each other. And this is what we're going to drive it with, specific force and angular rate, in our during our tests. There'll be some noise, and there'll be biases. And we use this, the nominal conversion factors that the manufacturer gives us, to get to physical units. So kind of going back again, we're talking about temperature-controlled enclosure that we're going to put this in, six-position static tests, six-position dynamic tests. So if you look at what we're doing there, the force in the body coordinates goes through some transformations. We start off in the local level frame, so this gravity is pointing down here. And this is the angular rate of the turntable that we put it on, and this is the offset from the rotation, center of rotation of the turntable. And then we have to go from the local level coordinates to the platform of the turntable, platform to the frame, the test frame, and that's where what we're going to vary the orientation with. We're going to make that at six different orientations. And then the transformation from the frame to the, I should say B for body coordinates for the accelerometer. We try to make this identity matrix and this the identity matrix by leveling everything up and squaring everything up. And this is our fancy rate table, okay? A real rate table that people use for testing really good gyros costs $30,000 or more, and we don't have that kind of budget. So some of you may be old enough to recognize this as a vinyl record turntable. Actually, it's two of them put together. One is a direct drive turntable, and the other is a belt drive turntable. I'll kind of explain why we did that. Sitting on here is a Lego fixture. Okay, that's because I worked with Kevin Knuth. I had to do everything with Legos. But no, in reality, Legos are manufactured to very high tolerances, so you can build nice square structures with them. And also there's a plate mounted on the turntable where we can offset that at increments, so we can do what we want to that way. The fans are on there because we're going to put it in an enclosure, and we want to get good circulation so the temperature is constant throughout. So underneath the turntable, there's a bunch of spots. And the reason those are there is, back in the old days, there was a neon, well, it's still on there, there's a neon lamp that's driven by line current. And you looked at through a little prism at these little spots, and depending on your whether you were at 50 hertz or 60 hertz, and whether you wanted 33 and a third RPM or 45 RPM, you got those to the strobe light, basically, to stop them. So we're going to use those with sensors here, which are just reflectance sensors that we bought from another hobby electronics place for like $2 each. So the reflectance signals are going to look like this. And they're different cycles per revolution. So we're hoping we can get enough difference in these things to be able to control this accurately, even at slow motion rates. That's yet to be determined, and that's probably the subject of a paper next year. Okay, so I'm getting 5 minutes here, so I got to go faster. We get DC motor belt drive. We're going to control it with a little microcontroller, and we're going to have a nonlinear measurement model. We'll probably use a particle filter to estimate the angular rate and position because of the nonlinear measurements. And okay, so we can take those measurement models and kind of rework them so that we have a measurement that involves things we know here as the measurement matrix, the forces we're and angular rates we're applying. And then we are trying to get these parameters about the model. Okay. And we can use an information filter form where we start off with the spec sheet numbers and probably increase them somewhat and process the data from these various tests. And then when we want to get this is the inverse information filter form of the model. So when we want the actual covariance and estimate, we do some inversion with singular value decomposition. So we're going to start with the nominal values, but then we're going to look at the residuals to make sure there's no structure in the residuals, to make sure they look Gaussian. We expect we'll probably see Markov process in there, and we'll probably have to go back and adjust the covariance matrix to reflect that. And there might be some nonlinearities. We're going to look at the estimates for that. And we'll deal with the temperature variation by actually using a lookup table for the various temperatures. Okay. Camera calibration and stereo rectification. The objective of camera calibration is to make this pinhole camera model really true for the image formation. So this is projective perspective projection. The problem is that real lenses have radial distortion, which you've probably seen, barrel distortion or pincushion distortion, and they may have some tangential distortion. So there's a method for dealing with that by using a chessboard. This comes from the OpenCV library, which is Open Computer Vision Library. And this is a good book in introducing it here. It's available open source online. These are standard methods for doing it. Basically, you gather a number of images of a chessboard, and then you locate the inner corners of the image at the subpixel accuracy level and use an iterative least squares method, Levenberg-Marquardt, to solve this for the distortion parameters. And if you got enough images, this works pretty well. It's not really Bayesian because it's not really giving you covariances or whatever, but anyway. The objective of the stereo rectification is to find a rotation of the two cameras' images such that their horizontal lines line up for the same object. That's because we're going to try to figure out the depth by the displacement of the object, the disparity here. And so it's much easier if everything's lined up on a horizontal line. And that's done in a very similar manner. You take multiple chessboard images with simultaneously from the two cameras, and then you can figure out the rotation. The trick is that you have to make sure you got all the points corresponding to each other properly, and they use this ransack method for that. These are pretty standard methods in the computer vision community. The IMU to camera alignment, we've got a little robot made with it's got actually a Wi-Fi transmitter that transmits the images. It has two cameras here. There's the inertial measurement unit, which we'll take off of our test rig and put it onto the robot. And it also comes with image processors from analog devices. And that was about $500 for that. So things are getting really cheap. The calibration procedure is we have to make sure we are hard mounted the IMU and the cameras to each other. We mount a chessboard at a known location and level it up so it's lined up with gravity vector. The inertial system can sense the gravity vector as well, so therefore we can coordinate the two. And by putting the camera at a known location, we can also get a heading direction from it. And there's actually built into our extended Kalman filter that we're going to use, there's equations for actually keeping track of that, or improving that estimate. And if we're too far off to begin with, we may have to use a particle filter for that. So, conclusion. That's our plan. Come back next year. Hopefully we'll be able to tell you some good results.
Didn't Planck say that? Any questions?
Thank you very much for a very interesting presentation. Could you go to the slide where that velocity is retrieved using integration of acceleration?
I'm sorry. Talk into the mic.
Okay. The slide which shows integration of accelerations.
For the navigation equations?
Yes.
Themselves? Okay. That's way back at the beginning?
Yes.
Okay. Takes a while, sorry. This one?
Yes.
Okay.
So, am I right that there is a problem when integrating accelerations, the error propagates exponentially, but here you will have also visual information. So, do I understand it correctly that you will reduce that accumulating error by incorporating visual?
Yeah, I didn't really go into details on that. These are the dynamics of the inertial navigation calculations and the camera calculations. That's the dynamic part of the extended Kalman filter. Then we linearize the measurements, and from that we can get updates for most of the quantities here. Almost everything there can be updated. And we feed those back immediately into the navigation calculations. So we zero out the errors to try to keep things so we can linearize around the solution.
Any more questions? Yes.
Julian, first want to say I just can't believe what an amazing conference this is. Yesterday, Professor Pollock went close to explaining the origins of life via crystalline water. And then today you topped that by showing me a photograph of the strobe pattern edge of a direct drive or a belt drive turntable, several of which I have owned for decades. So I'm not sure, did you imply that you used one belt drive and one direct drive turntable for particular purposes, or was that all you could scrounge?
It was a scrounge. I bought two turntables off of eBay. One was a direct drive, one was a belt drive. I took the belt drive apart, the motor, and luckily there's also a belt rim on the turntable of the direct drive one, and kludged them together.
So. I love it.
It's about what's useful, right? Any other questions?
Yeah.
Julian, how are you dealing about the factory extraction issue? You have some, for the calibration of the camera, you have some chessboard of specific dimensions. But in general, how are you considering what approaches for factory extraction from
for
the image?
For feature extraction.
Yeah.
Okay. There's a method that's currently in vogue in the computer vision community called SURF. For speeded up repeatable features, I think, as I remember. And if there's an open source that you can get of that. Essentially, it's doing kind of like hard transform of the feature, or the neighborhood of the feature. And so it's getting I don't remember how long a dimension, I think 64, well, yeah, I guess you can adjust it, 64 dimensional vector that describes that local area. And then it's been found to be accurate to about 15 degrees off axis. So as long as you don't move too much, you can see that, you can look for that same feature. And you compare what you see by doing its transform and doing a vector comparison.
I think it was in your previous slide where you had the overall block diagram of the overall system flow. No,
I'm not going
one
back
before that.
For some reason. Oh, got so many things.
Yeah, there you go.
Yep.
Comment what you put the Bayesian information filter there for the purpose of what?
Well, okay, so now it's okay. We do optical flow, and we have some method where we can take the entire image and look at the changes in that image and come up with a six-dimensional measurement of the angular rate and angular and linear velocity of the body, of the robot, okay? We then feed that into an extended Collin filter, basically. So we have a prediction of what that is from the navigation system, and we can measure what we saw, and then the difference feeds into the
I actually had a much simpler question. Is I was wondering why the information filter block wasn't maybe at the final end before it goes into simultaneous localization and mapping.
Well, that's because I left out a line. No, this is right. The Bayesian information filter resets the inertial navigation calculations as soon as it gets an estimate. So this is kept updated. So this is the best information we have at the moment. So that gets fed to the simultaneous localization and mapping. And then the feature information gets in there too, so we can have features to put on our map.
Okay, let's thank the speaker.